I'm serious, Hestia. In order to take care of him, you must follow those three rules. Not two, not four, and five is right out. Remember those five.
Goodness.
Three rules.
Excuse me, but what is...
No! There are literally no exceptions to those three rules. Not following them would just lead to some serious shit going down for the both of us. Just take care of him while I do this. Maybe it wasn't such a good idea, letting the house take care of him. Wait, Canbot, you... No, don't record yet! Thank you so much, Canbot, for making me look like a sloppy idiot who can't count. Anyway. Sup, everyone. I'm the cartoon physicist, and this is Noilus, taking apart the good, the bad, and the forgotten of the new millennium. Now, since this is the first episode, kinda, I think it's best for you to get to know me better first. Well, here's where to start, I guess. I love cartoons!
I'm not kidding. I'm bloody in love with cartoons. Hell, it's even in the name. I love a handful of cartoons from today. I love cartoons from the 90s. And cartoons that certainly go even further back. In fact, my number one favorite cartoon and my all-time favorite show is Animaniacs.
Well, technically, it's in a tie with Mystery Science Theater 3000, but I didn't have the heart to bump either one down to number two, so to me, they're both number ones.
But here's the thing. I didn't grow up with any of them. The cartoons I grew up with were from the 2000s, or the noughties. But I've noticed something about cartoons and the internet recently. All the shows that people have been praising currently are now over a decade old, and all the kids that have watched those shows are now much older.
For crying out loud, it only seems like a little while ago Avatar just started, and I actually just started university a few weeks ago. And I don't mean The Legend of Korra, I mean the first bloody series.
My point is, shows from 2000s wouldn't have been considered nostalgic a few years ago. But now that they're over a decade old, and that viewers of these shows are becoming adults, currently being the majority of internet users, I might add, I think I can able to look over these shows a lot deeper than we ever have before.
Sure, there are a few review shows that do that, but still only a few, and I want to join in. You know what? I'm not just going to review cartoons, I'm also going to do live action shows and films. But I'm also not only going to review the good stuff either. As an internet critic, I'm contractually obligated to tear bad shows and movies a new asshole. Yes, people, there were bad cartoons in the 2000s. My generation merely did their best to avoid and forget the worst, like the plague. Or at least a very forgettable plague. Meanwhile, I'll do my best to look into shows and films of indeterminate and debatable quality, as well as TV shows and movies that were forgotten. Hence, the show's motto, taking apart the good, the bad, and the forgotten of the new millennium. I'm going to explain to you more about the selection process later, However, I feel an introduction isn't enough to give you a taste of what's going to come. When in doubt, make a surprise list. The top 5 current Cartoon Network shows viewers avoid but are actually good. Or at least decent. Why top 5? Because Cartoon Network doesn't really air that many shows anymore. So what, 4chan does sing telegrams now, or?
You have been judged for your mistakes.
Hey, Astira!
Yes, miss?
Why isn't the security system working? I thought it was able to keep out teleporters.
The 3 individuals in question had materialized from the inside via data streams.
Then why the hell didn't you sick the guard dogs on them once they arrived?
They are otherwise occupied.
You have been judged for your mistakes.
You're going to have to be a bit more specific. The word mistake has been tossed around more than once in my life.
We are the cybersecurity community. Jury judge and executioner of the internet. This is Randall, the guardian of trolls. Leading in general of countless
he's just typing gay, emo, and outdated text abbreviations over and over again.
And this is King Maiden, the guardian of the memes, an artist at work. Ha, grumpy cat, you're still hilarious. Oh well. And I'm Phoebe, guardian of the viral videos. I could make or break you. You have been judged for your mistakes. There is no room for lies, inconsistencies, and oversights under the vast worldwide web. There shall be no end to your first year's misleading errors. Being ridiculed of the very nature of them who drill into your skull.
So you're just basically here to nitpick.
Indeed, you have been judged for your mistakes. We question the Anu, your eternal and virtual punishment awaits.
I know you're trying to be dramatically vague, but details are important when illegally prosecuting someone.
You claim to be a critic of media from the decade known as the 2000s, and yet you were about to this television program recently made in the 2010s. Additionally, you are likely to receive many comments from your viewers as they believe for the show you're about to list suck balls, as Randall would put it.
First off, really? The cyberspace trinity. You do realize that barely anyone has used that term for the internet since the 90s, right? Secondly, yes, these shows are current. After all, it's in the title of the list. You see, this is only an introduction, not an official review. It basically allows me to provide insight on cartoons in general, as a cartoon enthusiast, to my audience. Without fully going to 2000 shows yet. Plus, I think the shows on the list, at least some of them, are getting the raw end of the deal just because they're new. Not everything new is crap. Yes, there are some bad cartoons nowadays, including on Cartoon Network. But it's not like Adventure Time is the only good Cartoon Network show. These shows just simply receive a wary attitude from the channel's audience instead of actual viewership. In fact, the list is ranked on both quality and amount of wariness. I want to change the mindset by telling viewers about the many positive aspects of these cartoons. Cartoon Network needs more appreciation and support now than ever, because these wary viewers barely even know that Cartoon Network is practically a gold mine compared to its rival channels at the moment.
The Disney Channel is crowned with the shittiest teen sitcoms I have ever seen, treating its young and impressionable audience like a focus group full of mindless pod people by never bothering to risk even one witty joke. It panders its audience with a steady diet of childproof, flavorless mush, thinking that's all kids will ever need. Hell, I wish it was flavorless. It's just over-the-top crap. So over-the-top to the point where it's just patronizing. This channel used to have dozens upon dozens of cartoons. Now there's only three. Three? Really, Disney? Well, three excluding their new line of Marvel animated shows that will never reach the bar that Avengers Mightiest Heroes have set. And you just know those shows only exist just so Disney could nourish itself on the popularity of Marvel's work outside of the comics. They're not even working hard on them. I mean, come on, a reality show about the Hulks?
Barbarian? Oh, don't you Hulks know how to flush? It's backed up! Oh, come on!
Don't you think Nickelodeon, once the provider of the most original programming, wouldn't follow Disney's example? Because guess what? It did.
Nickelodeon does have more cartoons than Disney, but at least half of those cartoons are the ones that have been running since who knows when, such as SpongeBob SquarePants, which pretty much doesn't hold up anymore, and The Fairly OddParents, still airing new episodes even though no one knows about that. The other half of cartoons, the new ones, only has at least one good cartoon amongst the crappy ones, latest incarnation of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. What's the rest of Nickelodeon's new programming? Shitty teen sitcoms, just like the Disney Channel. As a matter of fact, Disney acquired its line of sitcoms long after Disney did, no doubt wanting millions of viewers, thinking having more viewers than Disney will make up for not even provoking one genuine laugh.
Donna, my point is we take Cartoon Network for granted. Before I go into the shows and movies of the 2000s, I would like to show my viewers what they're missing out on, as told by someone who knows good cartoons when she sees them.
Very well, you may begin your list, but be warned. We are always watching.
So anyway, the top 5 current Cartoon Network shows viewers avoid but are actually good, or at least decent.
Number 5, The Looney Tunes Show. I understand why a lot of people hate this show, I really do. Fans don't like seeing the masters, no wait, the pioneers of cartoon physics being stuck in seemingly boring situations. But even as a die-hard fan of the classic Looney Tunes shorts, I don't mind it. The reason why it's at the bottom of this is because it's more of a decent hit or miss show than an actual good one, but that doesn't mean it's utter crappy drag.
I believe every piece of storytelling has both good and bad elements. The best film in the world might have at least one microscopic fault, and the worst film in the world might have at least one redeeming quality. What usually defines a novel, a film, or a TV show as something bad or good is the measure of the narrative's flaws and strengths, basically which outweighs the other. What I'm trying to say is while the Looney Tunes show does have a significant number of flaws that outweighs its strengths, somehow the strengths make up for its flaws.
The way I see it, the show is a look into what the Looney Tunes characters' lives would be like during their retirement from the usual shenanigans in one day, a time very different from the 1940s, 50s and 60s when they were in their prime. So that means Looney Tunes' sense of humor has to adapt to the way the world is now, or at least today's social attitude. In other words, less slapstick that people in their world would immediately assume is abusive behavior, and more of the dialogue-oriented humor that is considered acceptable in society, while ensuring hygiene to ensue. Sometimes it's lackluster, like the 21st episode, French Fries, which is just a typical two friends mad at each other so the third friend tricks them into being friends again sitcom type episode.
They came with my sandwich!
So you didn't get me a gift basket?
No! You got me a gift basket!
I didn't get you a gift basket!
I got the gift baskets! I don't care about the French fries! I just want to go to the game!
Well, you know I'm going to the game!
But sometimes the dialogue is very effective. Like my favorite episode of the show, Jailbird and Jail Bunny. It depicts professional smart aleck Bugs Bunny being practically in heaven when he's in jail, and surrounded by intel targets who aren't allowed to hurt him, as though it were a tribute to the classic Looney Tunes shorts by exploring what made Bugs Bunny so appealing to begin with. His love of messing with people who are dumber, uglier, and stupider, bit redundant, I know, than he is. But what makes this episode so entertaining to me is some of the exchanges of dialogue between Daffy Duck and Bugs, like this one.
Nice backup plan. Look on the bright side. At least it can't get any worse. Indiana bold predictions? One day this country will send a man to the moon. That's already happened. Am I a wizard?
That cracks me up every time. Not to mention that the old shorts have used plenty of dialogue-oriented humor before, so it isn't such a big change. Hell, one of my all-time favorite shorts mainly consisted of dialogue with excellent use of twisting one's use of words, thereby using that type of humor more than slapstick humor, as though they were saying, "Ha, you see, it doesn't always have to be all about running dynamite sticks and anvils. You can make funny cartoons with mainly words. Take that, Hanna-Barbera."
"Would you like to shoot me now or wait till you get home? Shoot him now, shoot him now. You keep out of this, he doesn't have to shoot you now. Ha! That's it! Hold it right there! Pronoun trouble. It's not he doesn't have to shoot you now, it's he doesn't have to shoot me now. Well, I say he does have to shoot me now! So shoot me now!"
I must admit, the dialogue in the Looney Tunes show isn't as ingenious as the exchanges in the original shorts. But that doesn't mean the show isn't funny. In fact, I kind of think Daffy has the funniest lines on the show.
"Give me your phone."
"When are you going to get a phone?"
"Never. Cell phones are like doctors. The calling plans are confusing, the buttons are too small." "Well, after high school, I just had to get away from it all. Get back to what's important. The land. I've got about 30,000 acres in Montana. Probably about 50,000 head of cattle. That's about 2 heads of cattle per acre. Yeah. I did it. I invented something so spectacular that every man, woman, and child will wonder how they ever survived without it. You know when you want bread, but you don't want the whole loaf? I call it Daffy Duck's equally sized bread pieces. The rest of the world calls it sliced bread." "What are you so upset about? I've never even seen you read the paper." "I don't read it. I do what normal people do with it. Day by day, slowly build a papier-mâché parade float." "What parade are you in?" "I'm not in a parade. I am the parade." "What did your parents do to you?" "I signed up after graduation. I heard the call of duty, and I answered." "Oh, this? What you call heroism? I call duty. Believe me, when you're doing your duty, you don't think about the fact that you're doing your duty. It's your duty. You just do it. You do your duty." "They say history repeats itself. Well, wouldn't it be amazing if you could visit the past and see what really happened for yourself? Of course, to do this, there would need to be a device. A portal in which your molecular structure was broken down and then reassembled in the exact same manner. You invented a time machine? No, but if there was such a thing, and you used it a lot, you'd probably need a big box with a handle on it to carry your stuff. I am not being dramatic. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to walk myself home. That's right. Walk home through this unsavory neighborhood, where I'll surely be set upon by ruffians and miscreants, street hustlers and road monkeys. None of whom, by the by, come close to being the kind of garbage that is Porky Pig. Now, good day, sir." "I'm Batman."
This does lead to one of the show's problems, the portrayal of bugs. The show tries to humanize Bugs, giving him more flaws than he needs to have. I'm all for giving a character more dimensions, but those flaws have turned Bugs into a dispirited yet uptight grouch, the opposite of who he really is, a confident yet cool-headed smartass who can get himself out of trouble just as easily as he can get himself in it. Thankfully, Daffy's sense of humor makes up for it. And that's what's at the core of this show. It's dual nature of bad and good aspects.
Despite having big problems, the small things make up for them. Daffy's sense of humor makes up for Bugs' new personality. Lola being a fully developed character and not a hot token chick makes up for the witch being nothing more than a sassy token black woman. Granny's former life as a badass spy fang of Nazis makes up for the Tasmanian devil being a pet dog. The adorableness of Macintosh makes up for Gossamer being a self-conscious child instead of a monster. Daffy's epic wizard dream sequence that should have had an Iron Maiden soundtrack makes up for all of the irritating music videos. Bugs' second redesign, looking like his non-purple self, makes up for Wile E. Coyote and the Roadrunner's disappointing CGI shorts, and so on and so forth.
You may find something huge to hate about the show, but then you find something small to love about the show just as quickly. It's enough to encourage you to keep watching. Seriously though, the new Lola is a huge improvement from the old one. The old Lola was just the bunny version of Pamela Anderson's character from Barbed Wire.
Don't ever call me doll.
Don't call me babe.
Number 4, GarageBand.
Thank you.
But I think people who look for a Cartoon Network show to watch online would avoid this one, mainly because of who one of its creators is, Todd Kaufman. He is the director and main character designer of that god-awful Toho drama franchise, designs that had everyone trying to make their own versions with other TV characters. Luckily, the designs in GarageBand are a bit better, a lot sleeker than the odd shapes involved in the Toho drama designs, although I still think it's the flash animation that's what most people are put off by. But what most of you are asking is this. What the fuck is GarageBand? GarageBand is a show about what else? A young garage rock band trying to make it big by trying out different looks and trends. But they suck at writing lyrics, so the lead singer, Corey, provokes his older sister, Trina, into writing in her diary so he could use her words as lyrics. You may have noticed that the way she writes in the diary is way over the top. Well, that's basically what the whole show is. Over the top weirdness. Almost up there with the same amount of weirdness as Sam and Max.
Well, Sam, the gorilla and donkey man apparently think we're someone else.
He's a zebra, Max, and that's what makes me a little suspicious. You see, in nature, a zebra wouldn't normally hang out with a gorilla. Plus, listen to this, a zebra can't drive a moon buggy, or any kind of car for that matter. You see, zebras don't have hands, Max.
Gosh, you're right, Sam. The gorilla should be driving!
I'm not joking. There's a cursed amp that raises the dead, a race between an ice cream truck and a music-powered car, evil space orbs that possess musicians, redneck genies, an evil auto-tune helmet, a sewer monster that just wants a boyfriend, a living plant that can brainwash people, runaway zoo animals, evil dream duplicates living in someone's mind, pirates, cyborgs, a demonic elevator, and a guitar with a mind of its own that wants to destroy music completely. And that's just the beginning. Little tip of the iceberg. They haven't gone on to season 2 yet. despite the show's epic weirdness, it does have a very simple and repetitive format. GarageBand tries something new, always getting ready for a gig, and then something weird happens. Then they get their lyrics from Trina's diary at the last minute. But the show takes advantages of the format by being self-aware of it, by having characters point out the flaws of the format or just point out the tropes and cliches of kids' shows in general, to a degree in which they're breaking the fourth wall. And I love it!
It's worse than the time we gave wishes to that dog and cat.
They're family. They'll realize they love each other soon.
No, they won't train the show!
Don't even need lyrics! It's a guitar game! All you have to do is shred!
Wow, what's Trina gonna do this episode?
I'm running from the puppets, cause they want me dead. I hope that I don't lose my beautiful head. Their noses are plastic, but I fear they can't smell. Their eyes are like windows, straight into it!
A very good example, and my personal favorite, is in the episode Rocker Size, when the band accidentally made three crotchety elder women into Hulk-like beings who then terrorized the town for not being proper. Corey's answer is the same answer in every episode. Music. Lainey, the straight man of the group, points out the problem of this plan like so.
For once, I don't see how lyrics are gonna help. We need a tank!
Although I gotta be honest with you, the awesome weirdness and the fourth wall jokes just distract you from the lack of jokes connecting to self-awareness and the fact that the characters are so one-dimensional that the way they speak is very exaggerated and blunt.
But hey, it's what makes the fourth wall jokes that much more hilarious, especially when pointing them out. Another thing that bothers me about the show, just a small thing, is Corey's monologues at the end of each episode. They are insanely cheesy, enough to make you cringe. I know it's intentional, but the show didn't really need it. What also makes the show so good is music. Well, not specifically the music, just the celebration of music. This show does its best to celebrate the existence of rock with unbound passion. While most shows about music just do at least one song that they go out of their way to claim is a rock song. I'm looking at you, big time mush. That's not a rock song and you know it! Whereas GarageBand does more than one type of rock song. Although their songs are fairly light, since it's a kids show and all, they don't hold back on showing how much rock has evolved from the old days of it just being blues played fast. Hell, sometimes they played music outside of the rock genres. The show has played soul music, jug band, rock ballads, polka, shock rock, country rock, psychedelic rock, speed metal, grunge rock, medieval minstrels, hip hop, just rock in general, and so much more.
As a passionate fan of different genres of rock music, I'm very grateful for the existence of a show that celebrates rock and music overall, instead of letting the genres be overshadowed by references to today's so-called pop stars in order to get with it with tweens. It may be nearly as over-the-top as the teen sitcoms I've talked about earlier, but it's actually clever and charismatic. Go and check it out. I mean it. This show has got me, of all people, laughing at a fart. Though, to be fair, it was a rainbow fart. All questions are invalid when rainbow farts are involved.
Fart rainbows!
Up we go, flying across.
Koopa rainbow shooting light out of our pants.
Number 3. Clarence. This show may seem like a stupid SpongeBob ripoff with gross-out humor and similarities taken away from a horrible cartoon known as Uncle Grandpa. Seriously guys, stay away from Uncle Grandpa at all costs. Clarence, on the other hand, you shouldn't avoid, is actually very good. Although it looks surreal with its art style, like with Jeff's head, how the hell did it get that way? Is he some kind of demon spawn from a geometry-based hell? Back on topic. Clarence is a naturalistic show simply about kids having fun. In fact, this show has the most accurate portrayal of little kids I have ever seen. When it comes to television's depiction of little kids, they are always either incredibly smart for their age, intensely bratty, or act like teenagers and adults. This is okay sometimes. It's not to say little kids can't have anything clever to say. It's just refreshing to see little kids how they actually are. They're not dumb. They're just starting to understand how things work in the world. Sometimes they get it, sometimes they don't.
I bet they're gonna make out.
No.
What does that mean, make out?
I don't know. But whatever it is, they're gonna do it.
What makes this show realistic is how it's character-driven and not at all dependent on tired plot lines. And that's what life is. We're not run by overused storyline cliches. Life is run by our own actions.
But you're all probably wondering one thing, though. Is the show funny?
Yes! And no.
Then what are you saying?
I'm saying no. But I'm leaning towards yes.
Then you're saying yes.
No.
Then it's no.
Not necessarily.
It doesn't use that much humor, as the show is reliant upon the appeal of the characters, rather than the jokes. But when the jokes are around, they do bring out a chuckle or two.
Your rock. We found it. You can't just own it.
Yeah, you can't just own it.
Another thing that makes people wary of the show is one little question nagging at the back of their heads. Is Clarence, the character, just another SpongeBob? Well, in regards to the character's innocence and optimism, yes. But unlike Clarence, SpongeBob is thoroughly apprehensive, which can lead him to his more annoying crybaby moments. Clarence is much more laid back and barely lets anything get him upset. I think SpongeBob could have learned some things from Clarence.
If you don't want to miss all the good stuff, you gotta get up before the sun does. Because the sun is lazy bones. Also, breakfast is a part of a nutritious breakfast. Probably the president.
And once again, unlike SpongeBob, Clarence's innocence and unstoppable friendliness doesn't make him ignorant to everything around him. There are some things that make him think twice, occasionally. There's always Jeff that points this out, trying to make Clarence understand that most of the things he does isn't normal in the eyes of society. Sorry, I couldn't help myself. One episode that demonstrates this fully is Honk. Jeff points out to Clarence that his impulsive desire to speak his mind might eventually annoy everyone instead of making everyone laugh, suggesting he should improve his communication skills to be more like his classmates. Clarence doesn't ignore this suggestion like SpongeBob would. He follows Jeff's advice. He watches TV to find someone he could learn good communication skills from. Clarence can't seem to find anyone that suits him until his channel surfing leads him to a Marx Brothers film. He's inspired by the one and only Harpo Marx to use a horn to communicate with everyone. Instead of fitting in like Jeff wanted, Clarence just found a simple way to have fun, to express himself. So Clarence isn't ignorant of what people think of him. He just would rather have fun than be socially acceptable.
Plus, I now consider Clarence, the character, to be even more awesome now that I know he was swept away from the genius comedy stylings of the Marx Brothers. Oh, hell yes, yes!
Number 2. Steven Universe. The show is about an optimistic preteen boy who inherited a magical gem from his now-deceased mom and wants to save the world alongside his older siblings slash maternal figures slash mentors in his life, powerful magic warriors known as the Crystal Gems. I think it's mainly because of Steven that most Cartoon Network viewers are wary of this show, thinking he's just another SpongeBob or even another Clarence. But there is one thing about Steven that makes all the difference. He's older than Clarence. Although Steven shares most of Clarence's traits, Clarence is still young enough to be in his own little world and share it with his friends, whereas Steven is just starting to hear reality knock on the door of his little world, so to speak. He deals with not having a mother around, what troubles does his future as an adult hold for him, his new feelings towards girls, the fact that he may never able to handle the hazards that come with being a crystal gem, the inevitability of growing up, how he can't always get what he wants, his self-consciousness of his body, and so on. Not to mention, his innocence leads him to having an awkward phase at the moment, since innocence seems to be most appealing in little kids. Although reality is an important part of the show, it's not the main focus. What matters in the show is the relationship between Steven and the gems, how Steven manages to look up to them, and how beings who are practically goddesses treat Steven like someone who isn't inferior to them. Amethyst treats Steven like a little brother, Pearl is overprotective of Steven like a mom, and Garnet is sort of like a cool aunt, although we don't get much in the indication of how she treats him, it's still there. I think she sees the potential in Steven, yet is fond of his carefree personality.
I prefer regular Steven.
And the gems need Steven as well, even though they don't realize it. The gems see Earth as like one huge thing to protect, but Steven is there to remind them of the little good things that make humanity the way it is. It's as though he's the bridge between them and humanity, there to keep them grounded and let loose every once in a while. Now there is humor in the show. Well, it does have its moments, especially between the four characters.
So, what's today's mission? I hope it's fighting a giant foot!
Oh, wait, Steven! I just remembered, Garnet had a special mission for you.
Really?
Yeah, she says, you have to slam your face into that bowl of cereal.
Okay.
Good job, Steven! You stopped the foot!
There is no foot! Not anymore!
Like Clarence, the humor is not all that matters in the show. What I think appeals to me the most about the show is its boundless creativity. The art design may seem cutesy and light at first, but it truly excels in its monster designs that are basically a fusion of Lovecraftian horror and simplistic adorableness, such as Fribo, the living mascot costume, and Steven's cat tumors. Ah, cat tumors, the cutest thing to ever be in your nightmares. But don't let that scare you. See what else the show has to offer.
I know, it's popular now due to the Ruby and Sapphire episode. But there was a lot of wariness at the beginning, mainly because of all the design changes and the fact that the show focuses more on a loud, awkward kid than the magical alien girls. So I think it still can be on the list. By the way, Steven Universe is the first Cartoon Network show to be created by a woman. Thank you for making history, Rebecca Sugar.
And number one, The Amazing World of Gumball. I can tell why a lot of people have avoided the show for so long. Was because it seems like just another dysfunctional family show like The Simpsons or Family Guy, but for a younger audience. Well, yes, that was the premise for the first season, but I suggest you skip the first season completely and check out the seasons after that. The show went through a huge change once it entered season 2. It matured. The art design became a lot sleeker, the jokes and personalities of the characters became a lot smarter.
I think he wants to get out.
But what about the butterfly effect?
Dude, how could something this cute be responsible for something as bad as a tornado? It's like blaming baby boomers for the state of the world. How can babies going boom ruin the economy?
Ooh, what's the matter, you scared little piggy?
Yeah, you're a fully grown man screaming at us, and if you continue, I'm gonna call the police.
No matter how much it rains, this city always smells lovely. What's this? Looks like three ski enthusiasts have just withdrawn their hard-earned wages from the bank. Better get down there, safely. Not so fast, gentlemen.
What a pleasant surprise. It's Captain Punch.
Hey! Hey! Hey!
Take this. Nice bunch of flowers. Hey, is there something on my shoe?
Just some bubble gum. Let me wash it off for you.
I'm gonna take you guys down to a nice restaurant for a Swiss fondue. My treat.
If you want me to teach you how to be direct, I can. But you have to promise to do exactly as I say. No questions asked.
I promise.
I want you to walk like a dog with an itchy butt.
I shouldn't have promised.
It's Baby Anais, the living baby doll.
She likes to eat her cookies.
It's Baby Anais, the living baby doll.
She likes to drink milk. She's really drinking it.
It's Baby Anais.
The living baby. Forget it, man. Let's try something else.
No. This gave me an idea.
It's the Annihilator!
With realistic Kung Fu Karate Chop action, she can break anything with a tiny hand! Nothing can resist her! Cars, trees, bricks, houses, her own face!
It's the Annihilator!
Oh, I love it when you're evil.
This is me at my most evil.
Do your evil laugh.
Run him over.
Come on, let's be real for a minute.
No, dude. The worst thing is that this guy's got two sweaters and he's not wearing either of them.
So, now we're friends. Do you want to share some girl stories?
Awkward.
Yep.
Okay, I'll go first. I must say things are going pretty well with me and Miss Simeon. Oh, come now. Just because you're students and I'm your principal, it doesn't mean we can't share a few. And I finally heard myself out loud. Goodbye.
It's grindcore.
Grindcore goes a bit like this. It's important not to mix it up with black metal, which is more like... Another common mistake is to confuse it with Viking metal, which sounds more like banging a trash can with an axe.
Thanks, Rocky, but aren't you supposed to be driving the bus?
And the show focuses less on the Wilson family and much more on their world that is jam-packed with a vast number of impressive animation styles, which, as an animation nut, I really do appreciate. In season 1, no one barely notices how weird their world really is. But in season 2 and so forth, they fully embrace the self-awareness of their world's insanity. Way more than GarageBand ever will.
Well, I fetched him up as best I can. But for the last time, I'm a nurse. I'm not a mechanic.
Well, I'm not a florist or a meteorologist or some kind of freak show owner.
But you don't see me complaining, do you?
I mean, They even had an anthology episode about every single living inanimate object, for crying out loud.
All of this and more, 'cause we're the amazing world of the
Sometimes the show just does self-awareness jokes about cartoon tropes in general, not just their universe.
What? But it always looks like that. Oh, that. That's because I put the child filter on the house.
What the? Wait, what's happening? It's like there's some kind of device censoring every gosh word I say.
Cursing is unsafe, Gumball. Words can hurt.
Dude, I don't even know any real curse words. I only know the mom-sanctioned versions.
But those words hint at the bad ones, so they need to be censored as well.
So what are we supposed to say when we need to vent?
Like when?
Like now.
Hello.
Hi, I'd like to complain about your cartoon. I disapprove of the use of dynamite. It is imitable and could endanger the life of a child.
Where would a child be able to buy dynamite?
Are you saying your channel and sponsors don't care about our nation's children?
Okay, no dynamite.
I'm sorry, we can't allow that either.
But a child can't lift an anvil.
But he might hurt himself trying. No running in the road. And, of course, no violence.
Oh, no. I wasn't really gonna bite his tail. The joke is that he's gonna give me my own tail.
No jokes, please. A child might laugh and choke.
Can we keep the music?
No, thank you. It's the gateway to rock and roll, which is the root of all evil. Repeat after me. It's for our own good.
It's for our own good. It's for
No, no, guys, wait, look! I would never imitate what I see on TV! Guys, come back!
You know you can't talk to the characters inside the TV, right? And birds can carry diseases!
Whee! Come on, guys, hold on to me.
Warning. These stunts are performed by cartoon characters. Do not under any circumstances attempt to imitate or recreate the majority of things that happen in cartoons. Obviously.
Leave this to me.
Did anyone see what happened? I'm pretty sure I didn't hit this guy.
Hey!
What's going on? I didn't even touch him.
I think Darwin still has the child lock on.
Twiddle? What, are they now censoring the sound effects as well? You guys go on ahead. This is going to be pretty boring to watch.
You do know there are more germs on a pair of buttocks than a toilet seat, right?
I don't care. I'm one of those people who never gets sick anyway.
What, a liar?
No, I just tell my body not to get sick.
Oh, really? And how do you do that?
The power of the mind over the flesh. I can control any part of my body. Watch.
If you remember well, 75% of Elmore was destroyed and somebody has to pay for it.
You mean it didn't all end well like it always does?
Here's your half of the bill for the reconstruction work. Why are you looking so surprised? Did you really think we lived in some kind of fairy tale? 'Cause wake up, buddy, we don't.
Weird. That lady gnome seems to think the things we did in the past have consequences in the now.
Happen if we roll with this. We're gonna have a fight. It's gonna look like we're losing, but then we'll win thanks to our heart or something. Then the sweater guys will respect us, and then we'll freeze frame in some kind of high five mega happy ending.
We don't know. What if it just
all this time we were able to move,
but nobody had the intelligence or courage to try.
Apart from this free-spirited young man.
He's different!
Let's get him!
Dude, wait! What about me?
Thought no one would notice. What gave it away? Did we mess up the back part?
No, it was the pixelated part!
An episode I truly think explores the regular cartoon self-awareness jokes fully is the first episode of season 3, The Kids, about how the protagonist, Gumball and Darwin, notice that their voices are deeper than usual. Obviously, in the real world, this is because their voice actors are now older. Instead of simply moving on to the new voice actors straight away, the episode focuses on Gumball and Darwin trying to figure out what's going on.
Next thing you know, it's all over the place!
Are you making fun of us because our voices are broke?
Your voice is not broken. They're breaking. It means you're growing up. Did you really think you would stay kids forever?
Yeah, kinda.
Isn't there something you can do?
No. Only a small percentage of the world doesn't age. Mostly people on TV.
The rest of the episode is about the duo going through an early midlife crisis. But when they finally accept they're growing up...
It's over, dude. If my voice went any lower, it would be on the ground. We're not kids anymore.
Maybe it's for the better. No one wants to stay a child forever.
Remember the wonderful times we've had. Those happy thoughts now make me sad.
They say it's not bad, it's just a new start. So why do I have this pain in my heart? Our childhood memories are getting hazy. But soon we could drive, go to college, and we both go crazy.
What was that? Dude, what's going on? I sound even younger than before.
That's it. That means we're in the 1% of people who never grow old.
Yay! We'll be kids forever!
We got what we wanted!
We're stuck in these bodies for the rest of our lives!
Yay! That's right. It's then and there that the new actors are introduced, making the whole in-joke about eternally young cartoon characters' ever-changing voices that much better. So, if you want to see the show's true strengths, just skip season one and give the rest of the show and its expanding universe a chance. Yes, it's not as deep as Steven Universe or Clarence, but still a quality show that is being undeservingly ignored and judged more so than others. Right, now that's out of the way, I think it's about time we get more in depth about the selection process of my review show. With TV shows, I don't take fan requests. You can if you want to, it's just mainly just in case I missed anything for my list. I spent a long time making a list of shows to review and mixed them all up into the Remandomizer of 2000. It will allow me to pick a show to review at random with millions of calculations and algorithms happening at once.
That's not a highly advanced computer. That's a hat with bits of paper containing the names of the television programs.
Don't be ridiculous. This is clearly a computer. You cannot deny the breakthrough science that it takes to make a computer look like a bowler hat.
Proceed.
Thank you. Now, if I'm going to be honest with you guys, most of the shows I'm going to review aren't strictly within the 2000s decade. Every show I'm going to review started in the 2000s.
And then why does your show's title lie, noob?
If you would just let me continue and explain, then maybe my explanation is actually more reasonable than punishable.
Very well. Explain.
You see, a lot of TV shows that are defined as the naughty shows actually started in the late 90s. So I expanded the release date timeline, for lack of a better term, from between 2000 and 2009 to 1996 and 2009. Sometimes I'll review shows that started in the 2000s and have continued to this decade, but that depends on what the show is and if it's completed. But I won't be reviewing shows that have started in the 90s and continue to the present day, like The Simpsons or SpongeBob SquarePants, since technically that means they're not related to just one specific decade, like the 2000s. They're what I like to call omnipresent television programs. I'll be reviewing English-speaking shows, but not anime. I've never really watched anime, and I think an expert otaku, if I got that pronunciation right, can you able tell me, commenters? We do that sort of thing all the time anyway. Can able to review anime. As for movies, I completely take fan requests. Though I'll sometimes review a film just because it's been on my mind lately. The release dates are much stricter. Only films from the year 2000 to 2009. But I'm not just reviewing feature films. I'm also going to review direct-to-video / DVD movies, made-for-TV movies. I'm all for ripping up Disney Channel movies and sci-fi original movies. And maybe fan films. I hope my viewers will request good films as well as bad ones. Although there are a few films I will not be reviewing at all. Take note, people. I will not be reviewing the Transformers films or the Twilight films for the same reason. They're so goddamn horrible that everybody and their grandma has already reviewed and riffed the hell out of them. I definitely agree with the reasons why they're so bad, like how they're just pandering to their target demographics' respective genitalia. But honestly, I don't have anything more to add, and I would just end up repeating what everyone else has been saying if I do review these films. I won't be reviewing Harry Potter films either. They are quality films. And the books are well written, but put your wands down. I literally have no feelings for them. They haven't ignited any passion within me, so to speak. I don't think I'll be able to make an entertaining review of any of the films if I don't have feelings for them. And finally, I won't be reviewing The Son of the Mask for personal reasons. The whole review would just consist of me crying my eyes out while curled up in a corner. And that's pretty much it.
Very well, but be warned. We are always watching.
Well, that's the end of that. I'm glad you now have an understanding of my show's premise, and please consider watching these recent Cartoon Network shows. We've got to watch more than just Adventure Time. It's an immensely awesome show, yes, and no doubt the best one on Cartoon Network. But still, we need a bit of variety. With that said, I can only hope the first TV show I'm going to review will be just as imaginative, profound, hilarious, and groundbreaking as Adventure Time is. There's no way I could possibly jinx myself or tempt fate with a statement like that.
Well, since I already have a pillow up, I'm going to take a nap.
Hestia, you only had 3 rules to follow.
I apologize, but I had to clean the creature straight away after it fell into a mud puddle. There was no other option.
I better deal with these guys before they have the chance. This might not be the weirdest thing you'll see or really hear on the show. Nope, not even close. I'm the cartoon physicist, and that's all, folks.
Familiar face across the city street, sitting in the doorway with a blanket round his feet. At first I didn't place him the way you often do. The last time I'd seen him,